Canyon Park Hotel. We're staying there because we can't go home.
Yeah, well, we've been away for like 2.5 years, and I guess we felt like tourists. San Francisco is a great city, and we just wanted to dig it one more time.
Right, the first thing I wanted to do was grab my guitar and go busking at the corner of Haight-Ashbury. It's arguably the most celebrated hippie site in the world, man. It's the epicenter of the Summer of Love bullshit backdrop to the symbolic death of the hippie funeral in October 67. The first ever human being just down the street at Golden Gate Park. You can come for a cone of Cherry Garcia ice cream from Ben & Jerry's. You can get it from anywhere else in the world, but it tastes different there. So that song, T-shirt Michael played, was Truckin'. It was performed just a few doors down from 710 Ashbury Street, former home to the band who wrote it, The Grateful Dead. It's like a tourist attraction now. Jerry Garcia and the Dead forged a countercultural identity that grew from the mid-60s, outlasted Reagan, outlasted Clinton, and it still exists today. Come on.
This is the house of a popular local band which plays hard rock music. They call themselves The Grateful Dead. They live together comfortably in what could be called affluence. The Grateful Dead themselves acknowledge they have used LSD. Their concept of a new style of life drawn from the drug experience.
What we're thinking about is a peaceful planet. We're not thinking about anything else. We're not thinking about any kind of power. We're not thinking about any of those kind of struggles. We're not thinking about revolution or war or any of that. That's not what we want. Nobody wants to get hurt. Nobody wants to hurt anybody. We would all like to be able to live an uncluttered life, a simple life, a good life, you know, and like think about moving the whole human race ahead a step or a few steps.
I could have The remains of the counterculture gather every year at the Jerry Garcia Amphitheater in McLaren Park. That's Jerry's old turf. It's called Jerry Day.
You can smell it?
Joe and I had made a point of being home for the annual celebrations. The 17th, I believe. We're both aware that this Jerry Day might be our last ever.
When the counterculture became subculture, the Grateful Dead just refused to quit, man. Those kids who missed out on the hippie bands, along with the quote-unquote real hippies, the Grateful Dead were a gateway through which you could snatch a glimpse of the revolution. Yeehaw!
You're not that mean, are you?
No.
My man? You're not that mean. Wow, nice man. I said you're not that mean, are you, selfie
stuff?
No.
Not a selfie stick. I'm taking pictures of you. We come here, we're on our way to Woodstock.
Are you? Oh, you are? Really?
Yeah.
No, I'm from Brooklyn, New York. See, Brooklyn Cyclone, see?
Like, you live in Brooklyn now?
Yeah. We come every Jerry Day.
Ah, groovy.
Absolutely.
Well, good luck. I hope it revives the spirit of love. You know, it was 500,000 people, and everybody was remarkably polite. Please, thank you, you're welcome. The point was that it brought a moment in time where everybody just did get together.
I mean, if I leave everything exactly the way they are, then I'm just taking up more room on the subway. I'm just adding to the noise.
I just saw a tremendous sense of humor in it. And Jerry Garcia always seems to kind of take it all with like a grain of salt and go, yeah, you know, I don't know, man. This is like just crazy. There's something happening in San Francisco. I don't really know what it is yet, but there's something happening there. And there's this new group called The Grateful Dead in spring of 66. You know, you had the Beatles and Dylan going on and all the other British bands, but all of a sudden there was this thing happening in San Francisco. And I think, oh God, I wish I could go there. This sounds amazing.
Summer of Love, yeah, That's catchy. And it avoids all that shit about war and poverty and capitalism. Point that camera on the long hair, the beards, the beads, the ratty clothes. Point that camera on the hippie chicks dancing naked in the park. And the drugs. Point that fucking camera at the drugs, man. Call it the summer of love, while we make a mockery of love and those who try to live it.
I mean, the media portrayed hardcore deadheads as ridiculous, lazy, filthy hippies who have no work ethic. And let's face it, some of them don't. But it's a subculture, but no real threat, man, you know? Those stable deadheads have jobs and responsibilities. They are the mainstream. They support capitalism and materialism. They buy tickets to the gigs. They spend money on gas or rides to get to the gigs. They're consumers. Drug taking is just a way to resist that reality. I mean, you won't find stable deadheads rushing to join a commune like early hippies did. The thought of no electricity terrifies most of them. It's just a brand of groovy escapism. I mean, but it is groovy. I mean, it's a long, strange trip for the Grateful Dead's Human Being show of 1967. We actually know a woman who named Catherine who attended that meeting. Catherine lives in Sonoma County, about an hour's drive from the bay where she was born. Together with her partner, Nagasiva, they run the Lucky Mojo Curio Shop in Forestville, California. Harmony and I both needed to recharge our mojos, man, so we decided to pay them a visit before heading east. Can you dig it?
Take a boot and touch a brand new shoe, but don't put that thing on me.
Don't put that thing on me.
I was already living way out in the woods, but
don't
I
put that
thing on me
in Golden Gate Park.
Oh, you better watch
it,
'cause she's tricky.
But even at that time, I had already made the break with Orange Rose. We had to travel from our communal farm up in from Washington, I took LSD, and I had a revelation that I had to leave the city. And I was looking out over it, and you could see at that time there was some pollution in the air that at night, and it still is the case, the sky would be red from all the neon lights and the pollution. And I looked out and I thought, San Francisco might as well be out there. It was a traumatic experience. It was a frightening vision of the collapse of civilization, which has come true. It isn't as if I was lost. It has come true not only in generalities, but in specifics.
But don't let him stay all night. And don't put that thing on me. Don't put that thing on me. Don't put that thing on me.
If you could imagine the hippie movement is being created by these different threads. As I said, some of them were introspective people doing a lot of drugs. People think of, you know, these as stoners. I was never a stoner type of person. I have to speak against that stereotype. Most of the people that I was associated with were not that type of person. You don't get up and milk cows and get up and milk goats and do veterinary work if you're a stoner. You can't do that and sustain that kind of work.
It's about contribution too, isn't it, in a way?
Well, you're giving about to showing the community. Up, it's about showing up for work in the morning.
Yeah.
You know? Not self-indulgence. And I found that this, what I call the city hippies, attended to just, you know, they would just get up and smoke pot and that would be it. That would be their day. And I'm like, it's not good enough for me. I really want to do things. I'm an active person.
Yeah.
It was not like, oh, it's really, you know, sure, it's beautiful. It's lovely.
Yeah.
Look at the green, you know,
yeah.
But it was really about, let's keep this safe. Zero population growth. These were the things that motivated us much more than, wow, let's make a peace on earth. I mean, I wanted peace on earth, but I thought there are two ways to make peace on earth. Number one, convert everybody's mind to an idea of social harmony and harmony with the other species. And I don't call it nature. I mean, other species, plant species, insect species, mammal species. The other is wipe out all but about 1 million people. Just kill them. Dead. Gone. And then we have balance of nature. It's easy. 1 million people, well, not, that could be on North America. 1 million people for the whole world. I don't care, really, at this point.
What I heard was, let's not waste valuable time working on largely unattainable goals like world peace. What I heard was, let's focus our attentions on population, resources, and environment. You know, without inflicting any more massive damage to the Earth.
I was the child of someone who had kind of missed the hippie generation. And the values and the ideas were inspiring to me. So I'm a radical political woman. She is, actually, except that I'm nonviolent. So the idea about a million people or 10 million, whatever, this resonates very strongly with me, except I want the technology to limit our reproductive rates so that we can do it democratically and without war. But I was into the radical politics only on an online basis, primarily.
I've thought about this a lot, and I'm pretty sure that Catherine is a survivor. The basic identity she had as a teenager has survived everything life has thrown at her. She's managed to resist the, you know, me society, managed to stay relevant by making no sudden conversions to Christianity, radical feminism, or the Republican Party. She's different to other old hippies we spoke to. I mean, most had strong outlier type of views. Some were affable, some were witty, and some were blunt. But in Catherine's case, she was all three. The only other person like that, really, was Jeannie Whitworth.
Gosh, I've learned these life lessons from going to Woodstock.
You know, I don't give a flip what people think. I'm just going to be who I am, who I've always been. But at the same time, I hope I can spread that love and that peace and that caring for each other.
I still miss. I will always miss those Americans trying to illuminate the collective unconscious and help humanity.
And I am waiting for my case to come up. And I am waiting for a rebirth of wonder. And I am waiting for someone to really discover America and Whale.
We all have a moral calling to buy as much land as possible and do nothing.
And I'm waiting for the age anxiety to drop dead, and I'm waiting for the war to be fought, which will make the world safe for anarchy, and I am waiting for a final withering away of all governments, and I am perpetually awaiting a rebirth of wonder.
We now know that the federally protected lands can be raped and mined and pillaged and taken away from us, and it's now happening all around us.
But it was a conscious decision on my part not to bring any kids into this world till I was sure it was going to be okay. And I'm not sure it's going to be okay, so I'm very concerned about it. It's just like, I don't know what's going to happen. It's scary.
I feel people should walk away from it. But the problem is, if we all walk away, I've got 2 acres here. I only use about half an acre. The rest, I just let the wild animals and plants live on it. I don't do anything with it. This is the reason. Buy 2 acres of land in Montana, in Utah, in eastern Washington, wherever you're going to buy it, whatever you can afford, and do nothing with it but pay the taxes, because all the other species on Earth don't know about taxes.
Enthusiasm for healing the planet, for eating sensible foods, minimalizing chemicals, working with the flora and fauna, learning about our minds. That all began in the 60s. Simple yet simply elusive hippie ideas that were right then and right on today. Like now, like right now.
We think we own this land. I'm only renting it, and I am renting it
from the U.S. government, and I have to pay them a tax, right? My county a tax. That's my rent. The deer don't know how to pay rent. The raccoons don't know how to pay rent. The oak trees don't know how to pay rent. The redwood trees, they don't know how to pay rent. Someone has to pay the rent for them, and that is incumbent upon all of us to pay their rent. What I really mean by paying the rent is we have to put all the other species on welfare. Okay. We have to be their welfare providers. If we don't, they will all be killed. I would like to say one more thing. Don't have a goal of being rich. Have a goal of caring for being part of a world network of what we call welfare workers or social workers for the good.
Yes.
Right now, I have a shop. I do tarot card readings, astrology, I do whatever I do to earn a living, and I've always done that. You should get some safe travel oil because you're going to be on this Woodstock journey.
That's right.
Yeah. All right, well, let's go.
I had no idea.
Get that on tape.
87 species of moths in Sonoma County.
There are 87 species of moths in Sonoma County, and that is one of the highest number of mosses per bioregion, and only one place has more, and that is in Sweden. There's been a lot of people who've come by and, you know, taken a look at the shop, and because we're kind of unusual for this area. This kind of shop really has more of a history in urban areas. Oh, there are safe travel, so this is for you.
Oh, that's me.
Yeah, thank you. So safe travel has in it the herbs and roots for traveling safely, meeting friends along the way, coming back safely, and always having helpers along the way.
I'm not trying to hide no scandal, I don't got no smoking.
So these are from the 60s, and these are the last ones I've got left. They used to be called donkey beads, and people wore them, hippies like me, made necklaces of them, and you could buy them in the East Bay, and you could buy them in San Francisco. I in later years, met the man who brought all of them. He was an Iranian Persian rug merchant, and he wanted small things that he could also bring. So he brought them over, and he sold them to a number of stores on Telegraph Avenue and in the Haight. So these are the last of the unstrung donkey beads.
It was around about then that Nagasiva had a carpe diem light bulb moment, and Harmony and I were just like, flip, man. Totally buzzed. It was like a perfect thought.
Would a donkey bead be an appropriate thing to take to Woodstock also?
Those is an old thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it'd be
nice
to leave something behind
from
here.
Those donkey beads, believe me, I wore them. Everybody wore them. Here you go. This is a little donkey bead that represents the handmade hippie jewelry.
Something we can put into the field, into the earth, on the famous field.
Sure. Absolutely.
Yes,
fantastic.
People tend
Thank
to
you.
Take from the field. It'd be nice to put
well, they do,
back in.
Very much. So, yeah.
I'm taking my piece of Woodstock.
Right, well, there you go. Put it in, someone else will find it and go, oh my gosh, it's a genuine
1960s. I know, some Woodstock. That's a beautiful thought. Yeah. After the visit to Lucky Mojo, our Woodstock journey felt more like a gratitude pilgrimage. We felt at peace with what lay ahead, right? Of course, we didn't, no one could predict what was about to happen to the world in 2020 beyond. No one's got a crystal ball, man. I mean, Catherine had one, but she wasn't gazing into it the day that we visited, right? Should have asked her. It may have been useful.
Well, you need help.
Just ring the bell.